Well, good day to you, and welcome to the new normal, our virtual art of the theater class. First of all, I want to say thank you for tuning in and watching this first in our series of video lectures. And I want to also begin by saying that I wish only the best for all of you and hope that you're doing okay and getting through this. Hopefully this will be a little distraction for you, something to occupy some of your time. It's certainly going to be a time passer for me as I edit these videos together and post them and pretend like you're here in my living room with me. So welcome to my home. It's good to have you all here. Don't lose your sense of humor. That's really important. And if I know this class right now, I know that you're probably watching this, if you're watching this, and maybe giving me a polite giggle. But now you don't have to offend me by worrying about whether you're laughing at my stupid jokes or not, because I can't hear you anyway. So in my mind, I'm going to imagine that everything I say lands, and that we have a rollicking good time together getting through the last weeks of school. Anyhow, I hope you're all doing well. Thank you for tuning in to this series of lectures. I'm going to hold office hours, as I said, during our normal class time, and those are going to be via Zoom. Hopefully you've received the link. I will actually post that at the bottom of this as well, the link and the login information to get on Zoom. So you can check us out on there and have a live engagement. It's not required. I'm not going to take attendance, obviously. Some of you don't have access to it, and you certainly don't have to do it every Monday, Wednesday, Friday morning, but I wanted to offer it as an option in case you feel the need to connect, in case you have questions or want to hold a dialogue with me about the subjects that I'm presenting and talking about, or anything in general. But today, we're going to start by talking about melodrama and how it led to realism. Now, just a brief recap. For those of you who may have forgotten in our extended vacation, we talked about the Greeks and the ancient Romans and how theater began, and we talked about how it sort of disappeared for a while during the Dark Ages when religion came into conflict with the theater, and then we talked about the sort of Renaissance, right? Commedia dell'arte, these traveling troupes of performing families who would go around the countryside and present their acts and then pack up and move on before they could get caught and get in trouble. And then we found ourselves in the Elizabethan times with Shakespeare and, of course, taking us through Elizabethan England and into Jacobean, which, if you remember, was the name of the time when King James I reigned. We're going to jump ahead a little bit now with our lesson on melodrama, and we're going to talk about the next big period in British and world history, and that is the Victorian era. And we specifically link the term melodrama to the period of Queen Victoria's reign in England. And there she is. If you're watching at home, she's lovely, isn't she? That's Queen Victoria, and she reigned from 1837 to 1876. As usual with my lectures, you do not have to remember years. I'm not going to test you on that, but that's just to give you an idea of when we're talking about. And we call her reign the Victorian era, just as we did the Elizabethan era, the Jacobean era. And again, it just reminds us that England had a lot of power in the world at the time, and England set the standards, and what was going on in England was pretty much going on everywhere else in the world in terms of fashion, in terms of social behavior, in terms of entertainment. So we're going to dig into that. Now, some of the trappings of the Victorian era include morality. A big sense of morality was key to living in Victorian times. Religion was important, and of course the Church of England set the standards, set the rules, and everyone was just expected to be part of a religious following and decorum. Decorum meaning sort of the social behavior, the way you hold your silverware to cut your meals, the way a woman would curtsy or a man would bow, the way people would behave with each other in society. All of this, throughout most of the world, was dictated by Queen Victoria. And Britain was at the height of its power at this time, so that Victorian morality really spread across the world. I love this quote: "They knew that the successful working of the vast industrial machine required a strict, inhuman discipline. The idolatry of respectability was the answer to natural waywardness, to pay one's bills, wear dark clothes, stifle individual fancy, go to church regularly, and turn aggression upon oneself in the form of worry about salvation became the approved common modes of pursuing the pilgrimage of life. And a couple of things I want to point out to you in this. As silly as it seems, wearing dark clothes, that was the fashion of the time. Stifling individual fancy, meaning there were certain societal rules that we all had to play by, and people weren't encouraged to have their own opinions or to make their own choices. They were encouraged to go to church and worry about salvation. That was the key trappings of the Victorian era. So plays, theater, entertainment, necessarily needed to follow. And what we get is a term we call melodrama. Now, if we were in class together right now, this would be a participation moment where I would ask you to raise your hand and tell me what the term melodrama actually means. Give you a second to think about it. And I'll bet we're instantly connecting the term melodrama with the term melodramatic, as in, oh God, Julie, you're being so melodramatic about this. We use the term melodramatic when we're talking about over-the-top behavior, broad reactions, things that are maybe more, a little extra, if you will. And to an extent, that is true, that is one part of what melodrama is, but I want to unpack it a little bit more. Where did this term melodrama come from? Because to be melodramatic is something that came out of the term melodrama. So, any guesses? I'm gonna guess that 16 of your hands went up and you got the right answer, and I'm gonna give you the benefit of the doubt. But here's the truth. Melodrama comes from the word melody, melodic drama. And why do we call it melodrama? Well, that's because all of the plays in melodrama had an underscore of music to create heightened emotional responses. These plays were very simple. They were good versus evil. That was it. There were no gray areas. There really wasn't a whole lot of backstory into the psychology of the characters, and there weren't layers of evil and goodness, and there's good in everybody, and let's look at three-dimensional characters. It was pretty straightforward. Good guys were good, the bad guys were bad. And to that extent, we had, typically, in a melodrama, a hero, a villain, and a damsel in distress. And you could probably guess that at the end of every melodrama, good always triumphs. So if we take these elements, and we combine them and think about them broadly, a piece of high-stakes drama with good versus evil, very black-and-white characters where the good guy is good, the bad guy is bad, and the woman needs saving, we have the good always conquering in the end, and we have the underscoring of music to create mood or emotion. We sometimes see melodrama even in our lives today. And I'll give you a moment to reflect and think, are there any examples of melodrama that you can think of that fit these categories? Good versus evil, very black and white, hero, villain, damsel in distress. Got something? First thing that comes to me is Star Wars. Star Wars, good versus evil, damsel in distress, Obi-Wan, you're my only hope. Think of Luke Skywalker's theme song. Right? Think of Darth Vader every time he comes onto the screen. Our bad guy comes on and we hear... So these have all the trappings of melodrama. Now, when we get into the later Star Wars films, the prequels and the sequels that seem to never end, sorry Star Wars fans, I'm over it, we see that we get a little bit further away from true melodrama and get into more of a three-dimensional story. But soap operas, like Star Wars, a space soap opera, like daily soap operas, all have elements of melodrama. Now, what was the point? Well, here are some of the points. Theater was meant for escapism and entertainment. Theater was meant to leave us feeling good about ourselves and our own moral compass, right? We were supposed to walk away feeling like we're good people because we were on the side of good. The acting was very one-dimensional and very heightened, right? There wasn't any sense of truthfulness or naturalism in this. We weren't meant to look at people in melodrama theater and see a reflection of ourselves. And we don't come to the theater to deal with anything real or anything important. Now.
Oh. The door, please.
Oh, Claudia. Please to accept. Please to accept useless Latin. It's useless Latin. So you say. I do say it. And you must pay the rent.
But I can't pay the rent.
You must pay the rent.
But I can't pay the rent.
You must pay the rent. Or else marry me.
Hard to imagine that this is what people paid to go see in the theater, but you have to understand that at this time, that was the choice. That was what was dictated by the ruling classes. That's what people wanted to see. Theater was not made to make anybody think or really feel in any way other than feeling good and lifted up by the fact that we had a moral compass, right? So that's the world we're living in. So basically, for the majority of the 1800s, that's what we were living under. And in America, during the Civil War, that's where you find the majority of American melodrama. So the theaters over here were doing the same thing. In fact, the night that Abraham Lincoln was shot, he was sitting in Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C., watching a melodrama called Our Country's Good. So maybe getting shot in the head wasn't the worst thing to happen to Abe Lincoln. Just saying. Is that inappropriate? Too soon? Just seeing if you're still awake. Let's talk about what happened next, though. I don't want to spend a lot of time on melodrama because it's not really worth it. It's just important to know what it is. And in our discussion thread this week on D2L, I'm asking you to brainstorm a little and think about if melodrama has an effect or a place in our time. I already mentioned Star Wars as an example to you, but can you think of any other examples of melodrama or entertainment that has elements of melodrama? Again, remember, good versus evil, musical underscoring to heighten emotion, good wins out in the end. I'll bet you can think of some examples. It hasn't gone away completely. But now, take a trip with me to Norway. But Norway's actually important in the development of theater because in the 1860s and 70s, a man named Henrik Ibsen cropped up and he decided to fight back against Victorian morality. We call him the father of modern drama, in fact. This is a Norwegian guy. Now, he was born in 1828 in a town called Skien, Norway, which is a little outside of Oslo, and he studied medicine in his life as a profession, but he was so much more interested in theater. In 1851, he moved to the west coast of Norway to a town called Bergen to work at the Norske Theater, the Norwegian National Theater, if you will. While he was there, he started writing and dreaming up his own plays. And in 1857, he moved back to the city, which was then known as Christiania, which is now known as Oslo. There's a little Norwegian history for you. And he became the artistic director of the National Theater in Oslo. So there are two major, major theaters in Norway, both of which are still in existence and still in use, and both of which I have seen performances in, and I've got friends that have worked in them. And Ibsen worked in both. When he moved back to Oslo, he started writing plays, and he felt that real life and modern domestic issues needed to be shown on stage, right? Melodrama wasn't reflecting what was really going on in the world, and he felt like we should be using theater to hold up a mirror to society. So he wanted to encourage the individual breaking free from constraints, and he wrote a play called A Dollhouse in 1879. Some people translate this to be a doll's house. Very often you'll see the apostrophe S. As someone who speaks Norwegian, I take exception to this. The actual name of the play in Norwegian is Et dukehjem, which means a doll house. And even without knowing the play, I'm sure you can figure out the subtle distinction between a doll house and a doll's house, because it indicates ownership. And Ibsen was writing a play about a woman who was trapped in a very loveless marriage, and she wanted to break free. She is the doll in the house, and in order for her to break free, she needs to leave her husband. So Ibsen writes a play in 1879 about divorce. And when Nora, the main character, walks out on her husband Torvald at the end of the play, we referred to that as the door slam heard around the world. Take a look.
I've been treated most unjustly, Torvald, first by father and then by you.
What do you mean? Both of us have loved you more than anyone else in the world.
You never loved me. You just enjoyed being in love with me.
Nora, what is all this?
Oh, it's true, Torvald. When I lived at home with father, he fed me all his opinions until in the end I held the same opinions. If I didn't, I kept quiet about it because I knew he wouldn't have liked it. He used to call me his doll child, and he played with me just as I played with my doll. When I moved into your house.
Well, that's no way to describe our marriage.
All right, when father handed me over to you, you arranged everything according to your taste. And I adapted the same taste. Perhaps I just pretended to. I really don't know. Probably a mixture of both, sometimes one, sometimes the other. Looking back on it, I feel as if I have been living a beggar's life from hand to mouth. I made my living doing tricks for you, Torvald, and that's what you wanted. You and father have done me great wrong. It's your fault I've never come to anything.
No, how can you be so unreasonable and ungrateful? You've been happy here, haven't you?
No, never. I thought I was, but I never have been.
Not happy?
No. Cheerful, that's all. You've always been so kind to me, but our house... it's never been anything but a playroom. Here I was your doll wife. Just as at home I was father's doll child, and my children as well. They've been my dolls. I used to enjoy it when you played games with me. Just as they enjoyed it when I played games with them. That's all our marriage has been, Torvald.
Well, there is some truth in what you say. However exaggerated and hysterical it may sound.
No, you are absolutely right. I'm not qualified. There's something else I have to do first. I have to educate myself. And you're not the man to help me with that. I have to do it by myself. That's why I'm leaving you.
What did you say?
I have to stand on my own 2 feet, if I'm ever to know myself and the things that are going on around me. That's why I can't stay in your house any longer.
Nora.
Leaving right away.
Are you mad? You'll do no such thing. I forbid you to.
It's no use your forbidding me anything now. I shall take what belongs to me. I don't want anything from you now or ever.
This is madness.
To go back home tomorrow. I mean, back to my old home. It'll be easy for me to find something to do there.
You can't abandon your home, your husband, and your children. Oh, have you thought what people will say?
I can't go worrying about that. All I know is it's something I have to do.
This is outrageous. It's going back on your most sacred duties.
And what, in your opinion, are my most sacred duties?
Well, surely you don't have to ask me that. I mean, your duties to your husband and your children.
I have other duties which are just as sacred.
No, you haven't. What, for example?
My duties to myself.
Before anything else, you're a mother and a wife.
I don't believe that anymore. I believe that before anything else, I am a human being, just as much of one as you are. Or at least that I must try to make myself into one. Oh, I know most people would agree with you, Torvald, and you'd be backed up by all sorts of books, but well, what most people say and what you find in books just doesn't satisfy me anymore. I want to find things out for myself and make my own decisions.
You don't seem to understand your position in your own house. There's an infallible guide in this sort of situation, you know. It's your religion. What about that?
Torvald, I don't really know what religion is. I only know what Pastor Hansen told me when I was confirmed. He told me religion was this and religion was that. And I've got out of all this and I'm on my own. I'll be able to think that over as well. I want to find out whether the things Pastor Hansen told me are true, or at any rate, whether they're true for me.
But that sort of thing is unheard of in a young woman. Well, if you refuse to be guided by your religion, at least let me appeal to your conscience. I suppose you have some sort of a moral code, or perhaps you don't.
It's not an easy question to answer. I don't really know. I find it all quite bewildering. The only thing I do know is that my opinions about these things are quite different from yours. I've also found out that the law is different from what I thought, but what I cannot accept is that the law is right. That a woman isn't allowed to spare her dying father or save her husband's life. I won't accept that.
Don't be so childish. You don't seem to understand the first thing about the society you're living in.
No, I don't. That's why I want to make myself part of it. I want to find out which of us is right, society or me.
Nora, I think you must be ill, feverish. You seem to have lost your senses.
I have never felt as convinced and as lucid as I do tonight.
I'd work night and day for you, Nora. I'd put up with any sufferings, any hardship for your sake. But no man would sacrifice his honor, even for love.
Millions of women have. Once you had nothing more to fear, then as far as you were concerned, it was as if the whole thing had never happened. Everything was just as before. I was your little lark, your doll. You were doubly careful of her in the future because she was so frail and delicate. Torvald, at that moment I realized that I had been living with a stranger for 8 years, and I had had 3 children by him.
Oh, not now, Nora, please. Wait until tomorrow.
I can't spend the night in a stranger's house.
Well, can't we live here as brother and sister?
You know very well that wouldn't last long. Goodbye, Torvald.
But you're my wife. You are now, and you always will be.
Listen, Torvald. When a wife leaves her husband, as I am leaving you now, legally, as I understand it, he's absolved from all obligation towards her. In any case, I absolve you from all your obligations. You're not to feel restricted in any way. I'm not going to. Complete freedom on both sides. Look, here's your ring back. Give me mine.
That as well.
That as well. It's all over.
May I write to you, Nora?
No, never. Don't.
Well, can't I send you
nothing,
money?
Nothing, nothing.
Can't I help you in
any way? No, I told you. I don't accept anything from strangers.
Can't I be anything but a stranger to you, Nora?
Oh, Torvald. There would have to be the most wonderful miracle.
What miracle? Tell me.
Both of us would have to change so much that... Torvald, I don't believe in miracles any longer.
I believe in it. Tell me, we'd have to change so much that...
That our life together would become a marriage. Goodbye, Torvald.
most wonderful miracle.
Now to us, that might not seem so revolutionary. Might not seem like a big deal. We see stories about divorce pretty much daily, and we just accept it as a reflection of life. But what you have to understand is, like many new changes in theater, this was revolutionary. So revolutionary that Ibsen got himself in quite a lot of trouble for writing this play. People were up in arms saying, you can't write a play about divorce. Women can't leave their husbands. And Ibsen's response would have been, but women leave their husbands. This happens. Why not talk about it? But remember, during Victorian melodramatic days, the idea was not to come and see real life on stage. The idea was to escape. And so Ibsen was breaking all the social rules. And after all sorts of pushback and getting thrown out of the country, Ibsen came back in 1881 and he writes a second major play called Ghosts. Now in this play, Ibsen basically says to society, okay, you don't want me to talk about a woman leaving a terrible and abusive marriage? Let's write a story about a woman who doesn't leave. And in this play, Ghosts, you have a man who is dead when the play begins. He's died of syphilis, which he is in, which he has contracted by sleeping around and becoming and being an adulterer. And he has passed on his syphilis to his young son, who is being raised now by his widowed wife. This was Ibsen's sort of middle finger up to society, saying, "Okay, we won't talk about divorce. We'll write a play about something else—a woman who stays with her husband." And as it turns out, Mrs. Alving, the main character of Ghosts, has chosen to stay with her philandering husband because a preacher who she goes to for religious guidance and counseling has encouraged her to. Well, now that the husband's dead, now the preacher's got some weird ideas about Mrs. Alving. You can see where this is going, and you can bet Ghosts caused quite a stir with society as well. And Ibsen again finds himself in a massive trouble. And finally, he writes a play called An Enemy of the People in 1882. And this was a political response. And actually, as I'm recording this and sending it to you, boy, is it a play for our time. An Enemy of the People is about a town in Norway where the main livelihood, the main source of income are these spas, these sort of health spas where people can go to recover because the water in the springs is supposed to be restorative. You have a mayor of the town and his brother, who is a doctor. The doctor has found out that the water is poisoned. There's something wrong in the water and he wants to expose it. The mayor of the town says to his brother, you can't possibly expose this information because tourism is our only source of income and the town will collapse. And so what you have is two brothers locked in a battle over right and wrong, over whether it's better to protect the lives of the people or to protect the economy of the town. And boy, oh boy, does that sound like what I'm watching on the news today. And that's not really to get political and to take sides, but it really is a dilemma. What do you do when the options are save people's lives or save people's financial stability, and save the economy? And oftentimes those come in conflict. And in 1882, Ibsen wrote this play, and boy, did it cause a stir. And it really was his final double middle fingers up to society, saying, you got to get your heads out of your asses, and you got to do something. You've got to act. So Henrik Ibsen, although his plays might seem a little dry to us today, caused a revolution. He created what we now call realism. He was the father of modern drama. He created this whole format of realism. And one of my favorite quotes that Ibsen said is, "The theater may be the only place left in the world where people can go to hear the truth." He was interested in exposing the lie. So let's talk about what is realism. We hear that term all the time, but I want to give you a definition of realism. We say that realism is selected facts from the social lives of ordinary people arranged in order to comment on that reality. And I want to highlight for you a few terms. First of all, selected facts. So realism isn't an attempt to show you everything. It's not an attempt to get inside the lives of the people every moment and watch every little thing. The playwright selects specific facts. So they might say, let me show you Tuesday at 1 o'clock as this domestic dispute begins. And then we're gonna jump to Wednesday at 4 o'clock and see what happens 24 hours later and how it's developed. And then we might even jump back in time to 2 years earlier and see where this might have come from, right? So the playwright is selecting facts from the social lives of ordinary people and arranging them in order to comment on that reality. So the hand of the playwright is very much involved when it comes to realism. With realism, the playwright wants to guide us towards a specific conclusion. Now, you might not agree with the playwright's conclusion. You might choose to root for one character or another. It might not be so clear who the good guy or who the bad guy is. But the point is, the playwright has crafted this play in a way to make a specific point. It's very hands-on, but it's meant to reflect the lives of ordinary people. That's realism. If you have any questions about that when we meet in our office hours, you can ask. But the majority of what we experience in our life now, on television, on film, and in the theater, is some form of realism. Selected facts from the lives of ordinary people arranged in order to comment on that reality. By contrast, we have another term that often gets confused and conflated with realism. That term is called naturalism. Naturalism and realism are very similar. We're still dealing with the lives of ordinary people. However, naturalism, by definition, is an attempt by the playwright to choose a specific slice of time and slice of life and to not subjectively involve him, her, or their self in it. Meaning that they're just going to pick a smidge of time, maybe 2 hours, if we're doing a two-hour film. And if the story that he's telling or she's telling or they're telling starts at 11 a.m., it's going to end at 1 p.m. It's going to be a two-hour experience. And it's not going to cut away. It's not going to flash back. It's not going to take us to lots of different locations. It's really going to say, this is almost documentary style. We are following the lives of these characters, and I'm letting you, the audience, decide what you think. So again, realism and naturalism are similar. The difference is, naturalism is slice of life, slice of time. So you're going to read Tennessee Williams' Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, and that's a perfect example of naturalism. It all takes place in the bedroom of our main characters, Brick and Maggie. We'll talk about that more in a later lecture. And it takes place over a period of time. It's approximately 2.5 hours of time in the characters' lives. It doesn't jump ahead. It doesn't flash back. And we are sort of almost voyeuristically watching these people live out their lives. That's really the distinction from naturalism to realism. Naturalism doesn't have that hands-on approach of the playwright choosing specific moments. I will also tell you that naturalism is very rare. We don't see it a whole lot, okay? If you saw the movie 1917, the World War I film that was shot and made to look like it's one long shot, that's naturalism. It's really hard to accomplish, and it doesn't allow the playwright or the screenwriter to jump around and select facts that they want the audience to see. It's much more slice of life, slice of time, subjectively hands-off. So I'm beating this to a pulp a little, but I want to make sure you understand the difference between realism and naturalism, okay? Realism and naturalism both search for truth in social reality. And as we get into the next series of lectures, we're going to talk about anti-realism. So you had to know that for every social or entertainment modality, there's going to be a revolution that shakes it off its axis, right? So we talked about how Stanislavski created a revolution in teaching natural acting. We talk about how Ibsen creates a revolution by introducing realism to the world and shaking us out of melodrama. We're going to, in the next series of lectures that I share with you, we're going to have a bunch of different isms that are anti-realism, that people rebel against them for a number of reasons. And with each one, I'm going to talk to you specifically about where the playwrights are searching for truth. And in realism and naturalism, that search for truth is in social reality. So the mission of these playwrights is to look at our social reality and say, what's the underlying truth in this? How can I tell that story on stage? So that's the key to realism and naturalism. Last thing I want to introduce to you as our journey through realism and naturalism is another very important playwright. This time we're going to Russia, and we are going to meet Anton Chekhov, who, along with Ibsen, was one of these pioneers of the new form of realism and or naturalism. And Chekhov is super important for a number of reasons. First of all, here's his dates, 1860 to 1904. Again, you don't have to memorize that. It's just to give you a little perspective. So he came a little bit later than Ibsen. He was a Russian playwright, also happened to be a doctor. So for whatever reason at the time, all these people studying the medical professions decided they wanted to be writers and playwrights. Anton Chekhov also was a brilliant short story writer, a great humorist. He had a very dark and subtle sense of humor, and a lot of times as we read his plays, they might be titled, for example, The Three Sisters, which is his probably his most famous play, and underneath it's subtitled A Comedy in Five Acts. A lot of people read that and go, where's the comedy? I don't get it. It's not Laugh Out Loud, Neil Simon, or Jackie Chan, or Adam Sandler funny. Sorry, I had a total brain fart. And you know what? I'm not going to edit that out. I'm just going to see if you're paying attention. Keeping it real during Corona lockdown. All right, where was I? Anton Chekhov, right, wrote these comedies that weren't very funny, but they kind of are in a very subtle satirical way. He is an early adopter of realism. So he didn't create realism, but he was one of the first big playwrights to jump on it. And of course, as I mentioned earlier when we talked about acting technique, Chekhov wrote for the Moscow Art Theater, which was where Stanislavski was an actor. So this connection is really important because as Chekhov is writing these realism plays, somebody had to figure out how to perform them. And Stanislavski's the guy I hope you remember from our earlier lessons. Stanislavski was the father of modern acting, and he said, acting is, say it with me, living truthfully, under imaginary circumstances. Very good. Very well done. I'm picturing all of you in your seats, by the way. I don't have my seating chart, but I'm picturing all of you in your seats participating and paying attention. Hi, Maddie. Good to see you. Emily. Hey, Presley in the back. Good to see you. Sorry, I digress. Anton Chekhov wrote for the Moscow Art Theater some of the earliest realism. Now, if Ibsen was interested in exposing the truth about major problems in society, major problems, divorce and syphilis and politics, Anton Chekhov was much more interested in a detailed study of human behavior and exposing the truth in the human psyche. And his plays, when you read them, they seem like nothing's happening because everything is beneath the surface. And in that respect, in that regard, Chekhov was creeping a little closer to naturalism. Now, we can't really call Chekhov's plays naturalism because they aren't slice of life, slice of time. They do jump around in time. They do have multiple locations. So they're not truly naturalism. However, within each scene, the style of writing, the style of acting, is what we would consider naturalistic. He doesn't write heightened crisis moments where characters are panicking and freaking out. He doesn't write big conflict moments that are very much on the surface. Everything is underneath the surface. Everything is very subtle. And that's much more like how it is in real life. And I'm gonna leave you with that. We'll sign off after this, and I will look forward to seeing you maybe in our virtual classroom in a little while, and also answering any questions that you have via email or the D2L discussion links. I wish you really well, and bye, everybody.